This is the Pebble Continuous Performance Task, PCPT, and it's modeled after the Connors Continuous Performance Task. And in this task, you can probably hear me hitting the space bar now. The intent is you hit the space bar, you make a response to any letter but a specific letter, the letter X. And, oops, I made a response to that. The default version of this task is about 14 minutes long. It's a continuous performance task, also a go-no-go task. People sometimes use these labels go-no-go and continuous performance as if they were describing different tasks, but they're really basically the same thing. You make a response only for some and not for other responses. And the way this is set up, in contrast to some other go-no-go task or continuous performance tasks like the TOVA or the Pebble go-no-go task, the target is always rare. There are some that in a second block of trials, the target will be very frequent. And so you're making a response all the time. And so you can measure both responses to the rare stimulus and responses to the infrequent stimulus, or the frequent stimulus. And you can see that I did about 15 trials that were very fast, and now I'm in a slow area where you're getting trials more slowly. And I think we'll look at the parameter settings for this, but there are three different timing blocks that are sort of continuous, that you don't get a break between them. It just changes without you knowing. So you can look at whether speeding things up also increases the probability of making an error. The probabilities of making an error are actually pretty, it's pretty difficult to measure in this type of task, because I think the number of intrusion trials, or the number of non-target trials, in this case the X, is about 10%. So if you do 100 trials, that's only 10 opportunities to make an error. But nevertheless, these are some of the statistics and measures used on this task to assess how people are doing. The Connors Continuous Performance Task, which this was implemented to mimic, at least it was implemented to mimic the some of the publications describing how the Connors task worked. To the extent that they described it wrong, this is probably not working exactly like the Connors task works. But over the past probably 10 years that this has been available, I've gotten a lot of people who have used both, suggesting changes to make in this to make it more like the other. But also, unlike the Connors task, which is sort of an all or none, you take it or leave it, you can adapt this with a bunch of settings to make it work in different ways, to make it work maybe to suit your lab or your context better. So I'm going to close this, because this will go on for 15 minutes, and we will look a little bit about its design and timing and some of the parameters. So the instructions here, or the basic description, it's modeled after a set of classic paradigms and implements a version of Connors Continuous Performance Task, or CPT. Now, Connors didn't invent or even invent the name Continuous Performance Task, but it is a commercial version that's widely used for diagnosis of like ADHD and attentional disorders of one type or another. It's a vigilance task, takes approximately 14 minutes. That's the default setting. 360 characters, approximately 1 inch in size, are presented one at a time. Participants must respond by pressing the space bar to all stimuli except for the X. Okay, so first let's look at some of the parameter settings that we can edit. There are a number of different continuous performance tasks, and there's a few papers describing the classes of these. Maybe the most popular version is the, other than the standard continuous performance, is the CPTAX. And this has been used to look at brain networks and conditional decision making and things like that. And at one time, I had imagined that you could embed them both in the same task and we could just change a test type. So I have this test type argument, but I've never actually used it because whenever and I have an implementation of the CPTAX, but it's just so much different that it's easier to keep it a separate task. So, for example, the instructions are different. The stimuli are different, the response blocks are different, so it just doesn't make a lot of sense to keep it there. But maybe sometime in the future, frequently people will ask me to, can they fix something? Maybe they want two responses, X and Y, and so we might make a test type two that can include multiple target responses. Cycles is the total number of blocks, so defaults to six, but the demo I have just set up and run just had two. Block size is default 20, and so I have this block size 10. So actually, the demo I gave would probably be 20. I was probably almost done with it with 20 or so trials. There's a presentation time parameter. You can have that target stay up longer than 250 milliseconds if you want. The target probability, how many of the stimuli are the target, whether to give feedback. This is probably not how Connors did it, I believe, and so it's defaulting to off. But if you turn this on, then it'll tell people when they're incorrect. This will probably disrupt the timing a little bit. Whether you should pause between blocks. This is one of the things that people have told me I should be in here if it needs to be more or less like the Connors task. And people have different opinions about what should happen. You noticed in the demo I just did, it went straight from a fast to a slow block. And if you do pause between blocks, it will interrupt that. It'll stop between them and then continue. It's up to you as an experimenter which one you want to do. And then there's this proportional foil. Proportional foil, it says, well, do you want exactly 10% of the trials to be X's, or do you want there to be a 10% chance of an X on each stimulus? It probably doesn't matter too much. Proportional foil is probably b a little bit better, because you can count on there being a specific number of targets. But there could be cases where you want it to have a 10% probability. The difference would be on any given block, you don't really know if you have 10% of the trials that are foils. If it's proportional foil and you're doing something like gambling, a task that a clever participant could count and understand. Sort of card counting, and know how many targets are left, and when they've exhausted the 10 targets from a block, they don't even have to look anymore. They can just hit X every time. It's probably pretty unlikely that that would happen, but you might be in a case where you want to prevent that from happening. Those are some of the parameters. I have them set to, oh, I have them set to this setting. The thing I just ran didn't actually use this. It used the default, but now that I have this, the default would be the default settings. This is these new settings I gave. Now if we so now let's look at what the data look like within actually, this is where the continuous performance task is located. If you open up the Pebble test battery, or the Pebble launcher, you select battery, then you scroll down to PCPT, Pebble Continuous Performance Task, and you select this to run it. Now, the data will be, this is usually in your documents or your My Documents folder. So there'll be documents slash Pebble dash exp 2.0 or whatever version of Pebble you're running. And so you can find the data in there once you've installed Pebble. If you're using a standalone version, it will be just within the standalone folder that you're running from. The data will be saved in the folder that the task is also saved in, making it for easily archiving the whole thing at once so you know exactly what settings and versions you used. If we say open this, it'll open up the data folder, and you can see that within Documents, Pebble, Battery, PCPT, Data, I have a different folder for each subject. And this is just me having run several times. That last one I ran was 140. Although there's a few from a different version in here, there's a couple things to look at. One is this log file. This will just log a timestamp and a subject code for the start and end of every task. So you can see here that this is the one I just started, and I exited early, so it never finished. Here's a version I started and finished. It took about 3 minutes, and that was with the short testing conditions. Here's several that I started and never finished. So 137 is one that should be completed. There's also a pooled version. So this will record one line per trial for every single trial and every single subject all in the same file. So this is an easy way to get a pooled data set that you could do repeated measures across subject analysis and things like that. So this is just a copy of the file for each subject or participant. So you can see 140 was the last one I ran. That those same trials will be here within the 140 folder, and so exactly the same files will be here. And now let's look at this. So at the beginning of this, I was talking, and so I wasn't making a response at all. Response time comes up as -1 when I didn't make a response. I get the condition, which is how fast the stimuli are apart. So in this condition, it was 1 second apart. I have a trial counter. I have a block, and you can see that block one was all 1,000, and then it moves on to block two when I go to a different ISI, stimulus interval. I can see what the target is, and here's an X, here's an X. So here's whether I responded, and since at the beginning I wasn't responding at all, you know, none of these showed up. It recorded the absolute time, and you can see that it's probably the absolute time of the start or of the response, I'm guessing. So you can see that it's probably the absolute time of the start because these are exactly 1 second apart throughout. You know, here we sometimes lose a couple milliseconds here or there. But overall, it's synced to the timing of the ISI. And here's the response time. And if you didn't make a response, then you didn't respond. Here's the respondent. So a correct trial would be where I responded to something that was not an X. And here's an example. I respond to an X, and it's scored as not correct. Here's a trial where I respond to a G, and it's scored as correct. So you could aggregate across condition or maybe block or trial to get more reliable values, and then also maybe aggregate response time for the responded trials. And also you want to count the types of intrusion errors and how many times did you respond incorrectly to something that you weren't supposed to respond to, how many times did you miss responding to something you were. Many of those parameters are going to be saved within this report file. Now, since I didn't complete that the whole experiment, this is empty, but I said there was that previous one. Maybe it was this one. No, it's not this one. We'll find one that it exists for. So 137, I went through the whole thing. It was a shortened version, so there was only 20 trials per block, but you can see the types of statistics it gives. This is, I don't know exactly, this is, should be redundant with this. Maybe this is just a mistaken printout or something, but this gives versions, subject codes, timestamps, and things like that. Some of the parameters that were set, you pause between blocks so you can record exactly what the arguments were. And then a bunch of statistics that are identical to the statistics that in a report that like the Connors task would give. So how many were correct? 18 out of 20, 18 out of 20, 18 out of 20 in these three ISI conditions. And the overall 54 out of 20, out of 60. Now, if you look at targets in each of these cases, because I had proportional foils on, that was 10%, and there were only two foils out of 20. So correct targets was 18 out of 18, 18 out of 18, 18 out of 18, which makes 54 out of 54. But so I was 100% correct on targets, but I was 0% correct on foils. I didn't miss the foil, I responded to the foils every single time. Target accuracy is 1 or 100%. Foil accuracy was 0 or 0%. Two commission errors in each one, zero omission errors. And now correct RT, this is just for the correct, as response time increased. And you can see that this is, it doesn't systematically change. It doesn't get slower, faster for me, which might be just partly because there's so few rounds and so few trials that it's not very reliable. Error RT, because I made errors, I can look at the error RTs. And oftentimes there are theories about whether people are making fast errors or slow errors. It looks like in two of these cases, my errors were faster than the main response times, and one of them was slower. If you have more than just two trials, this you might be able to make inference about this. And then some signal detection theory statistics. Of course, these are not going to be very good because I had 100% foils. And for these to be good, you probably really want either a lot of trials or a different paradigm where you have more a larger proportion of foils. All right, well, that's some of the statistics that you might pull out for an individual. You could calculate these on your own, or you could calculate them, or you could just pull them from this file if you wanted to. There's, of course, a few things within the experiment that are not available to parameters. And so if I open this up, we can look at these a little bit. Here's some details that this is the paper that I based the method off of. So maybe there's other versions of this paper, other papers that describe different, slightly different methods. Here's all the arguments we looked at. But here's some things that are not available. Now, first is the ISI values. So you might think 1,000, 2,000, 4,000, I don't want just that. So you could change these. You may be able to add four different ISI values. That might be feasible. I'm not completely sure. But you probably can't go much faster before it becomes almost impossible. And maybe slower would be fine as well, but too much slower, and you're not going to gain anything. There's a certain point of time where you might make a response failure, or you might accidentally make a response, but just adding more time won't matter. You could also make these all the same if you wanted to. I don't know, if you're doing this in an MRI machine and wanted very specific timings between each trial. You can also determine what the target letters are. So it might be, like the Pebble Go No Go task uses only P and R. So you could use just two letters that are very similar, like E and F, which might increase the number of errors because of visual similarity. I guess you could make these words. You probably could change these so they're words as well. I don't think there's anywhere where I don't think you can change X as the target, though. Well, you can't easily change X as a target. You could by changing other code elsewhere. But you could probably make these words with X's in them. That might introduce a higher kind of false alarm rate. And this, I guess this 0.9 is hard-coded as well. So 90% is hard-coded here. It says target probability 0.1. But there are places here like this that it's hard coded. So probably if you want to change the number of targets, you're going to have to either wait till I fix this eventually in a later version of Pebble or change it right here. Okay, so that's some of the things you could change. I guess the issue with changing the ISIs is that a lot of these reports at the end are based on these specific ISIs. You know, I have these specific ones. If you have four, it may not give you a report on those other things, and it might not even succeed because it may be filtering based on these recorded ISIs. So it is sort of, I guess it's sort of linked to the specific ISI that you happen to that it's designed with. You know, you could de we could develop other in the other continuous performance tasks like this that give you a lot more flexibility. This is sort of designed to work like this published version, and so a lot of this is hard coded because actually hard coding it makes it easier to build these reports and things like that. Okay, so we looked at some of the things you can change within the file, some of the things parameters you can set, and what the data look like. There's a few things you can translate. So just by selecting the Pebble file and hitting translate, it gets you to this window. And there's not much here. I guess the only thing that's a little bit interesting is this footer, which probably doesn't exist prior to a vert like 2.1, Pebble 2.1. In 2.0, this isn't an option, but later it will be. It's something I recently implemented that you can have a little message on the bottom of the screen that just reminds people, hit spacebar for any letter but X. And I've found that, you know, like if you've done the task a lot, you know that. But if you're not quite paying attention when you start, it can be helpful to have that reminder because you could think that you're supposed to hit the Enter key or the X key, and your data will be absolutely no good because you'll be hitting the wrong button throughout. This isn't how Connors did it, but it seems, you know, so maybe if you want to be as close of a work-like of Connors as possible, you should have leave that off. But it is pretty reasonable experimental design to have that as a cue to help you. So that is, but you could also change this to anything else. So to translate to this another language, you can, you know, maybe you want to translate to Spanish, hit ES, and then each of these you can type a translation. And actually, this is a little trick that I added because it's annoying to have to, you know, because this is all written in Pebble and it doesn't have access to a lot of text editing things. You can clear like that and type by right-clicking on these buttons. So I'm going to reset to default, quit without saving, so I don't mistakenly confuse that I have a overwrite the Spanish translation. Actually, we can look at what translations are available too. So people have translated this into Italian, Portuguese, oh, and the AX into Portuguese as well. All right, well, that is the Pebble continuous performance task, the PCPT. It's designed based on descriptions published by Connors to look like and work like the Connors continuous performance task. It's completely free. It's available as part of the Pebble test battery at pebble.sourceforge.net. So if you found this video useful, please subscribe and like and all those things you can do on YouTube. And thank you.